Yom Kippur is a time to to look at fundamentals. Let's try to look at a subject that is certainly fundamental in Jewish thinking, in Torah. And since these meetings are designed to be Torah learning experiences, let's try to study a subject in Torah together, which is at the basis, the foundation of Torah understanding. Hopefully we'll be able to derive a new dimension of insight into Yom Kippur and what it's about as well. And that is the subject, the question of idolatry and astrology. See, we can use a correct understanding of this fascinating and difficult subject to home us in on the at least one of the central dimensions of Yom Kippur and what our focus should be. You can't hear me? The problem is this. Let's try to set up the question or the questions, and from that perhaps the answer will suggest itself. The problem is this. You're aware, I'm sure, that idolatry, worship of idols, what we call avodah zarah, strange worship, is forbidden. I'm sure you're aware of that. You must also be aware that it's the major prohibition of the Torah. It heads the list of all the negative commandments. On a deeper plane, it contains all of the negative commandments. And that presents us with a list of problems. Astrology, we'll see, Mitzvah Shem, how it fits in. Let's first build up one clear picture, one clear side of the picture. The question is this. Our picture, certainly in the Western mind, our picture of idolatry, the worship of idols, is the worship of something that really doesn't have any existence. The concept we have is of someone who makes a graven image, carves a shape in wood or stone, and then attributes divine power to that thing. It says that it created the world, it created him, it has power over his life, and so on. The most fundamental problem with this is how silly that is. In other words, something that the Torah prohibits with such seriousness cannot be something that is such a silly delusion. Again, someone who carves a shape in a piece of wood and then says that it made him, that individual needs, you know, psychological help long before he needs religious help. You know, long before that person is guilty of transgressing any prohibitions of the Torah, they transgressed human common sense. We would credit an intelligent 10-year-old, 5-year-old, with knowing that if he made a shape in some inanimate material, that it has no power, surely. The first problem, perhaps, long before we get to Torah, is to understand how people could do that in the first place. What does that mean? And if they are as deluded and as extremely deluded as that, why would the Torah make it a prohibition? There is a prohibition in the Torah not to be silly. It's true. It's brought down in certain places that there's a general prohibition not to be foolish. But it's way down the list in terms of importance. And this is the central prohibition of the Torah. So the first issue is, what exactly does this mean? What is this worship of idols which seems so crazy? And secondly, why would the Torah make it its most important prohibition if in fact it's nothing? And thirdly, even more perplexing, is why does the Torah deal with idolatry as if it's real? The Torah deals with idols, with foreign gods, strange gods, as if they're very real. The Torah doesn't say, don't worship figments of your imagination, don't be deluded, don't do that which doesn't make sense and that which is foolish. The Torah doesn't say that. The Torah says, don't worship other gods, referring to other gods. The Torah doesn't refer to things that don't exist. It says quite clearly, the second of the Ten Commandments, which contains all the negative commandments, says, Lo yelecha Elohim acherim, you should not have other gods before me. It uses quite clear words. Why would the Torah prohibit something and mislead you, so to speak, into thinking that it exists if it doesn't? If other gods are just a figment of some South Sea Islander's crazed imagination, then why would the Torah refer to his gods, which are in fact nothing, as if they exist? That's extremely problematic. And if you look in Tanakh, throughout the Tanakh, you'll find verses from beginning to end that relate to other gods as if they're real. Anyone have a siddur here?
Is there Shabbos on?
Shabbos? Thanks. There are verses throughout Tanakh that refer to other gods. We say, for example, Ki kol Elohei ha'amim elilim, because all the gods of the nations are small gods, diminutive gods. And then you're supposed to pause before you continue, and then you say, Vashem Shemaim Aso, and Hashem created the heavens. In other words, again, because all the gods of the nations are small gods, but it says that they do exist, and Hashem is different, He created the heavens. What does that mean? Who are these gods which are small? Who are they? Exactly, what are they? Ki Godol Hashem Umul Al Moed, Hashem is great and greatly to be praised. Noirahu al kol Elohim, He is awesome over all the gods. It says quite clearly, over all the gods. Ki kol Elohei amim elilim. Any number of psukim, any number of verses that you care to look at, you'll see refer to gods other than Hashem. It's even more difficult to understand. What's even more difficult is the fact, on a much deeper level, that when the Torah, and this is really impossible to understand, when the Torah relates to these foreign or false gods, it uses the same names that it uses for Hashem. At a deep level, that's by far the most difficult question. We've studied together in these meetings previously the idea that Torah is always located in its words. It's always the words that express exactly what they mean, the depth of the concepts, the depth of emanation of all the energy, of all the meaning within Torah bursts forth from the word itself. And no words contain that idea more potently, more powerfully than the names of Hashem. And when the Torah wishes to refer to false gods, it uses divine names. It's quite true that it never uses the name of Yudke Vavke, Hashem's name of essence, as it were. That's never associated with idolatry. But all other names, all the other names of Hashem, whether it's Elohim, for example, we talk about Elohim Acherim, other gods using that name. Or Shem Adnus, Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, that word is used. Or Kael, Aleph Lamed. What does this mean? If these gods are false, if they're imaginary, if they're illusions, then why does the Torah refer to them as if they're present, and uses divine names for them? Furthermore, this is not just a major prohibition, but as we mentioned, it's the major prohibition of the Torah. What sense does it make that the major prohibition of the Torah, the one that contains all negative commandments, should be something that is completely and utterly empty? Foolish. You know, we have a tradition, and I think we discussed this before Rosh Hashanah, that the closer you are to the beginning of something, the more all-encompassing that point is. If you're at the beginning of the Torah, or let's, for example, understand Torah in this context as beginning with the first of the Ten Commandments. There are different ways you can understand the Torah as unfolding. But at the level of our set of instructions which the Torah contains, we understand that the Torah is focused on, or centers on, or spreads out from the Ten, Aseres HaDibros, the Ten Commandments. The first of which is Anochi Hashem Elokecha, I am Hashem, the mitzvah, or the concept, different opinions, of faith, of emunah. And the second, of course, is the negative side of that concept, which is that I am Hashem, there are no others besides me. Now we have a deep tradition that where a thing begins is the totality of everything that it is. In the first of the Ten Commandments, in other words, is contained the whole Torah. That's a well-known principle. In fact, it says in Chazal that the whole of the Torah is contained in the Ten. All ten are contained in the first one. Not difficult to understand. Anochi Hashem Elokecha means the essence of Hashem. You know that the word Anochi is not the same as Ani in Hebrew. Ani in Hebrew in Torah means I in terms of my relationship with that which is outside of me. And Anochi means I in terms of myself alone. Anochi in Hebrew is the deep expression of the essence of self. Ani is an expression of self as it relates to that which is beyond me. Anochi Hashem Elokecha means I in my essence, that is in fact all that there is. Ein Oid Milvado is nothing besides Him. Of course, that contains everything that emanates from that center. And that's why all of the ten are contained. In the first one, there's a deeper concept that all of the first ones contained in the first word. Anochi, again, from what we've said, should be plain, at least the beginning of understanding. And all of the Anochi is contained in the Aleph, which is the beginning. Why the Aleph? Because the Aleph, again, Kabbalistically, an Aleph, if you don't have to know much Hebrew to know that an Aleph is comprised of two Yuds and a Vav. You know, the two Yuds, the Yud, which is the ultimate ten higher energies that come down from the higher world, mirrored by their ten reflections in this world, and how the two of them are linked by the Vav, which is always the letter in Hebrew that means connection. Vav means and, it's a conjunction letter in Hebrew. A Vav in Hebrew means a hook, that which joins. And of course it's the ten being linked to their image and their product, what they produce here in this world, linked by the method of connection, which is what an Aleph is. Of course that adds up to 26, which is Hashem's name. And the Yud and the Yud and the Vav adds up to 26, which is Yud Kei Vav Kei. That's what Hashem's name is. Obviously that's the point of beginning. But the concept here is that the Aseres HaDibros, Ten Commandments, they begin at the beginning. The beginning is not just a point of beginning, but it's that which contains everything. And we have that idea constantly, the idea that in the 6 days of creation, the world was created in the first instant. It did not take 6 days. It only took 6 days for a revelation of what had been present in the first moment. Exactly as when genes fuse and the conception of a child, it's the moment of fusing of the genes that, in fact, at that moment, everything is laid down, everything is created. The pregnancy is only the experience of revealing what was coded in those genes, and as the child grows later, there's a further process of revelation. But everything's contained in the first moment. Now, this must be familiar to you, and it's not our direct subject this evening. But there's a second aspect of this, and that is that when the first point of a process unfolds or reveals itself in the second point, from there on in, the second becomes the first. The second then contains everything that it's received from the first in more manifest form, and it contains all that will come later. If you want an analogy, it would be that the moment of conception is the totality in infinitesimal time and space. The totality of the child is laid down, but then there's a second stage, the pregnancy. The pregnancy is the phase of development where all of this comes out, but of course it contains all that will come later. And of course the third contains all that will come after it, and so forth, and so on. We're saying that the second of the Ten Commandments, which is the prohibition of idolatry, contains all the rest of the Torah. More specifically, according to the more Kabbalistic breakdown, the first of the Ten Commandments contains all the positive mitzvahs. And the second contains all of the negative mitzvahs. And I'm sure you can hear that. The first is I am Hashem, which means all aspect of relationship with me is contained in that nucleus. And then there are none other than me, which means don't break down this relationship with me, don't damage it, don't be disloyal, don't go elsewhere, contains all of the prohibitions in the Torah, which in a sense are all breakdowns of the relationship. The center of every negative command is really breaking down a relationship with Hashem. That's really what it is in ultimate essence. In real essence, the center of every positive command is building a relationship with Him. After all, you're doing what He wants. Every negative command, you're doing what He doesn't want. Whatever the negative commandment is. And all of those are contained in the concept of not being disloyal. Don't break down our relationship. Which is more important? Which of these two is more important? Which is primary, the positive mitzvahs or the negative mitzvahs? The mitzvah of emunah, belief in Hashem, relationship with Him, or the prohibition of idolatry and all the negative commands? Which is primary? Obviously, if the first, which contains the second and everything else, is the positive mitzvah and contains all positive mitzvahs, obviously that's primary. What is the relationship between the primary and the secondary? The sources say that, amazing idea, that all positive mitzvahs, any positive mitzvah that you fulfill, builds something in the spiritual world. Nefesh HaChaim goes into this in detail. Any positive mitzvah that you perform, you take a lulav and sukkahs, matzah and pesach, whatever it is, any positive mitzvah builds aspects of the spiritual worlds, which then bring down energy to this world, build tremendous cosmic realities. But the fulfilling of a negative command does not build anything. You know that? When you fulfill a negative command, you construct nothing at all. You achieve nothing. When you walk past a jewelry store, yes, on your pensive way home this evening, you're going to walk past one of the richly laden windows. And as you resist the temptation to pick up a brick on the pavement and heave it through the window, no doubt you'll resist the temptation. It's the day before Yom Kippur. You're going to resist the temptation to grab the goods and run off down the street. When that happens to you, you build nothing at all. It's true, you strengthen your character and you build your self-control and discipline, but you build nothing in the higher worlds. You only avoid breaking down what has been built, but you build nothing. This is why the positive mitzvahs are always compared to parts of the body. You know, there are 248 positive mitzvahs, just like there are 248 limbs or organs of the body. Because each part of the body is essential to the body. But the 365 negative commands are compared to the days of the year. They're not parts of the body. They're the framework within which you operate. The construction of a reality that is the context, but they're not. Or sometimes the positive commands are likened to the 248 organs in the body, and the 365 negative commands are compared to the sinews or tendons, which again are not essential parts of the body, as it were. They bind and hold together the rest of the body. In that sense, they're essential, but they're not the organs or limbs themselves. The negative commands are the framework. They maintain what's been built. They maintain the framework. They don't build anything. How can we understand this? Let's try and go a little bit deeper. All human thought, speech, activity, all Torah activity, all mitzvahs, everything that exists in the world fits into one of two categories. Either into what we call Ahava or into what we call Yira. Either love or fear. There's no other possibility. Love means all that is a movement towards, a desire to be one with, a desire to bond with. That all falls under the positive side, the positive mitzvah side, the side that's called Ahava, called love. Then there's the negative side that's called Yira. It's any movement away from, a cringing or shrinking away from. That's called Yira. That's called fear. All mitzvahs of the Torah fit into one or other. Everything in life, in fact, fits into one or other of those two categories. Which is primary? Love or fear? Which is primary? Obviously, the love side is primary. When you get married, for example, you get married. There are two aspects to marriage. In building a successful and deep relationship in marriage, there are two components. One is what you must do in order to build the intimacy and the love and the depth. And the other is be careful not to be disloyal in any way so that you break down what has been built. Those are the two requirements. Which is primary? Obviously, the love is primary. You don't get married in order not to be unfaithful. But you need the serious marital counseling if that's your... You don't get married. You don't enter a relationship in order not to break the relationship. You enter a relationship in order to build the relationship. One of the aspects of building the relationship is that you must take care not to break it down. But obviously that is secondary. Every activity of building has also a secondary activity of maintaining and protecting, especially in the world of negativity, which is why we have the negative commands. Those are the things that are protecting that which has been built. If a person begins a factory, person gets a lot of investment together and he begins a production. Brings production, builds a factory, a plant. And the factory produces goods. You'll notice that some of the invested money goes not into the factory, but it goes into a barbed wire and electrified fence that he builds around the factory, and some of the money goes to the salary of the guards with the vicious dogs that patrol the perimeter of this factory. Did the fellow begin a factory so that he can have guards and guard dogs and electrified fences? Of course not. The purpose of the exercise is what he produces. It's unfortunate but necessary that when you produce things like that, you also have to invest some of your energy in guarding that which is being produced. Is this clear? But you don't do that as a primary effort. How can we demonstrate that the construction is primary and the guarding is secondary? The most beautiful, perhaps one of the most beautiful demonstrations is that in Torah, we have an incredible principle called Esei Doicha Leis Aseh. An essay is doicha eloisa ase. A positive mitzvah pushes away a negative mitzvah. An amazing idea. Let's try and get this clear. It's a halachic concept, but puts its finger beautifully on what we're saying. Let's say you have to do a positive command, and in order to do it, you have to do a negative command. You have to go, you want to use a lulav and esrog, but the only way you can get it is by stealing it. You have to transgress a negative command. Right? Would you dream of doing that? You're taking much too long to answer. Of course not. Of course you wouldn't do that. You can't use a forbidden means to a correct end. You can't do that. It's ridiculous. You can't do that. However, there's an incredible concept in the Torah that if one and the same act fulfills the positive command and the negative, then you're obliged to do it. You hear that? There's a halachic concept that if you fulfill in one action, the same action, not an action in order to get to another action. We're not talking about means and ends. But if the same single action fulfills a positive command and at the same time transgresses a negative command, despite the fact that the punishment for negative commands is far greater than the punishment for omitting positive commands, which needs explanation, you're obliged to do it. Incredible. Example. I see some puzzled faces. You want to make tzitzis. You wish to make tzitzis. What do you have? You have a four-cornered garment and you have threads that you can tie on your garment to make tzitzis. What's the problem? The garment that you have is calico, flax, linen. A linen garment made from flax. The strings that you have are wool. When you put those woolen tzitzis on your flax garment, you're fulfilling the mitzvah of tzitzis. But you're transgressing the prohibition of shatness. You're transgressing the prohibition of having bound together in one garment a woolen flax. The Gemara says, Torah says, you do it. Mate, why? Because the point of negative commandments is to protect the positive and the positive things that have been built. In the moment of achieving the positivity, there's no danger. Now, again, nothing needs to be protected if the act of protection is itself the act of building. There's nothing to protect in that moment. Are you with me? And therefore, since the whole point of being here is to build the love, so at the moment that the love is exactly being built, there's no protection needed because the achievement is there. Remarkable thing. What of course needs explanation is, if this is true, why is the punishment so much more severe for negative commandments than for positive? For breaking a negative command like hurting someone or stealing or... The punishments are much more severe than the omission of positive. You didn't eat the matzah on Pesach. You forgot to eat matzah. You didn't shake a lulav. It's not good. But the punishments are negligible compared to the commission of negative commands. Why is that so? But the answer is obvious. The answer is obvious. The lack of fulfilling a positive commandment, of course it's not good. But it's not... Nothing's been damaged. You only fail to build. But if you do a negative commandment, you break down deliberately. Example. You've been married a few months, and you forget to bring flowers on Friday afternoon. Men, of course, yes. You forget one Friday afternoon after having a very good record. You forget to bring flowers. It's not good. Not good at all, I can assure you. Don't even dream. If you made the mistake of bringing flowers every Friday when you got married, you better continue for the rest of your life. So you didn't bring flowers. So it's not good. But can you compare that to having been disloyal in some way? The lack of having built something is terrible, but it hasn't been built. It needs to be built. Something's been omitted. But it cannot be compared to the power, the damage, the pain of having committed something that breaks the relationship. That's why the punishment for negative commands is much more severe. But it doesn't alter the fact that the point of the exercise is the positive and the building and the love that is the point of the exercise. And therefore, positive mitzvahs are the point of the Torah, and the negative ones are only the protection, only as it were, the protection, the avoidance of breakdown of that which has been built. Now having said all that, but all of those negative commands, which are all necessary framework in order to build the positive and build our relationship with Hashem, all of them are contained in the one negative commandment of idolatry. That's how important it is. So again, we come back to our problem, which is, if it's so silly, if it's so foolish, and you know the Torah itself points it out as foolish, The Torah does two things. The Torah, on the one hand, relates to idolatry as if it exists, talks about other gods as if they exist, and on the other hand, mocks it as being nothing. You know that mockery is never allowed. You must be aware of that. Mockery is one of the most deeply negative human characteristics. A person who has the trait of mockery is a person who cuts himself off from any serious possibility of development, because nothing's important. Once you mock, you belittle, you undercut the importance of anything, and that's why mockery is such a negative trait. There's one thing that you're allowed to mock, in fact it's considered a mitzvah, and that's avodah zarah. Idolatry deserves not just to be negated, but it needs to be mocked in order to show how absolutely ridiculous it is. How does the prophet do that? It's well known. The Navi, the prophet, when he wishes to mock idolatry, he scoffs at the individual who takes a log of wood, cuts it in half, uses half of this log of wood for firewood in order to warm himself, and with the other half he carves a shape that he then calls his god and begins to worship this shape. Now, how ridiculous could that be? In other words, mockery of the nothingness, the emptiness of this idolatrous concept. But on the other hand, the Torah relates to it as if it's real. This very God that this crazed individual is worshipping, the Torah calls names that are divine names and relates to it as if they're real. This is a very, very perplexing area and needs a lot of thought. Let's see if we can try and find our way through this area and hopefully come out with something new. Are we together with a problem? Anyone out there? Not going to enjoy the answer unless you share the problem. There's a center of Torah this. Yom Kippur is a time for getting to essence, getting to essentials. No time on Yom Kippur to start adjusting all the bits and pieces. Not enough time in one day. Yom Kippur is the day to understand the fundamentals, understand the core of your personality, and shift that. That's where change has to be made. It's the God of the fundamentals of Torah. So let's understand. Now, in order to understand this subject correctly, we'll need a little bit of background that comes from the deeper sources. This is more or less Kabbalistic material. It comes from the more revealed part of the hidden. But nevertheless, this is what we need to understand. These things are written openly. The concept is like this. You can look it up yourself in the Nefesh HaChaim if you wish to go into more detail. But let's try to bring out the element of the subject that we need for understanding our subject. There's a concept that the world that we live in, again, this is very, very difficult and abstract ideas, and we have to make some sort of a very, very flimsy picture in our minds in order to get some concept, but let's do the best we can. The world that we live in is the end result of an endless series of worlds, each of which produces the ones below it. If you wish to, if you cast your mind as high as you can, in fact, we're not allowed to go beyond a certain point, but if you imagine, you think about what the ultimate source must be, at least as high as we're allowed to delve, there's a point of origin there which brings out a product, a certain, what's known as Elamas, a certain, one of the worlds, one of the spiritual worlds. That world brings out a world below it. These all have names and they're discussed in great detail in the Kabbalistic literature. That world brings out one below it and so forth, until all the way down at the end of this whole endless series of birth which is being produced, the last one, the second last of these worlds, brings out the world that we call Asiya, the world that we live in here. The world of the tangible and the finite is the final result of a cascade, if you like, or a chain reaction of creation of worlds. In fact, there's a world outside of this one which is called the world of the external forces, but that's another subject. But in terms of a simple model, this world is the last one in a series of worlds that are devolving from the ultimate source down here. Why is this the last? Because this is the first time in the sequence that a world emerges that is limited, in which the dimensions of objects are only what they are. In the higher worlds, the source of any object in this world is plastic and flexible. But when that object manifests in this world, it becomes finite and limited. Again, in this world, any object has certain dimensions. It extends from here to there, and that's all. It's not bigger and it's not smaller. For the first time, there's a crystallization or concretization. Things achieve a tangible reality in this world because this is a world of finite limitation. If you go higher than this, angels, for example, malachim, are flexible, multidimensional creatures. They can manifest in many shapes and forms. There's no contradiction between forms. In this world, one thing can only have one form, can't have two forms. And that's, of course, the point of this world. That's why you're here. Because in this world, you inhabit a body, and you operate on a stage of tangible, finite objects, so you can make a difference. You can make things happen. You have to be... That's the one side of it. The other side, of course, is that a world that finally gets as frozen as this is a world of darkness. And that's why you have free choice. But that's not our discussion this evening. Our discussion this evening is simply this. That in this cascade of worlds, try and stay with me carefully. In this cascade of worlds, the last one is this finite world. Let's go back again. Let's go up and come down. Where are we starting? Listen well. We're starting at a point in which things are so close to the ultimate oneness, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, that there's by definition up there no differentiation. All things are one thing. Right? Can we understand that? No. And we're not trying to this evening. But that's, you know, the Kabbalistic wisdom, a beautiful way that it's been put, that it's put by the Mekubalim. They said that the truths in the Kabbalistic area are things that you can have a yadir but not a hasoga. It's a beautiful way of putting it. You can have a yadir but not a hasoga. Means you can have a knowledge but not a grasp. Beautiful. You can know what it is. You can repeat the words. You can say, well, yes, all different things are the same thing. You can say that. Can you grasp such a thing? No. But the mitzvah is to know it. Down here, you have to grasp. You have to grasp in Torah what you can grasp, and you have to know what you have to know. In the higher worlds, all points of origin of things that will be differentiated, down here, there are all one. That's what Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad means. That's what... However, down here, things that are separate, they're not one. One object in this world is not another object. There is a oneness that runs throughout this world, and again, that needs to be demonstrated, but again, it's not our subject. So let's understand the dimension that we say. We're saying that there's a chain reaction or cascade of worlds. The point of origin is close, is an ineffable, inexpressible and ungraspable oneness. But it comes down through a series of changes that eventually ends up as a world of differentiated, finite, isolated, separate fragments. Now, hear well. You have to say that somewhere in that chain, there must be a world that's intermediate. There must be a place somewhere that both reflects the oneness and the breakdown. There must be. If there's a... Are we together? If there's a... Yeah? If there's a, the Maharal says that anything that's junctional between two other things has the characteristics of both those things. If a thing is junctional, if it joins together two things... Glue, for example. Glue must have the propensities of both objects that it glues together. It must be able to bond to the one thing, but it must also be able to bond to the other. That's how it holds them together. It's a remarkable substance that can link to one and another, which are opposites that don't link to each other, and it links them. Is this clear? If you say that we start at a world where everything's one, and you end up at a world where everything is separate, there must be a point somewhere in between where the oneness becomes separate. There must be. That world happens to be the second last of all these worlds. That's not the point for now. That is the world of the zodiac. That's the world of the astrological forces. The world of the stars. The world of, we're not talking about the planets and the stars. We're talking about a much deeper concept. The planets and stars are some kind of indication of this world. But that's, again, that's not for now. This world called the astrological world, what we call the mazalot, the mazalois, right? Mazal meaning, in its putrid English translation, you know, luck. I'm not talking about luck at all. We're talking about, you know, mazal in English, is that reliably and accurately, with perfect, absolute sensitivity. English translates all Torah concepts as exactly the opposite of what they're supposed to be. You know that? Exactly. You know what mazal, you have to understand this, you know what mazal means? You know what mazal means? You know the zodiac signs are called mazalos in Hebrew, right? You know that. There are 12 of these mazalot, right? You know what a mazal means? It means it means that part, that world, which is able to take an undifferentiated energy coming down above it and break it up into the particulate energies that come down and strike each person and each event and each moment of time and each object in this world. And thereby create it and conduct its affairs. Mazal means the bringing down of a higher energy into this world in the correct fashion. Mazal means the connection between a higher world and a lower world. Stay carefully with me. If I were to give you an example, I'll show you how English mistranslates it, but let's try and get the concept. It's not English, of course, it's our minds. The concept's like this. Can I give you an analogy to put this a little bit more plainly? Imagine you had an immense white light shining down. Brilliant and immense white light. And at a certain point it strikes a prism. And it goes through a prism. What comes out the other side? 7 differentiated separate colors. You have to say that all the colors must have been there before. They must have been there. You couldn't see them. Are you with me? Isn't that a good analogy? You should be jumping up and down on this side. It's beautiful. No? You tired? I'm either a bad teacher or you are slow. Yeah. Again, if you have a white light shining down and you see it splits at a certain point because it goes through a certain medium, in this case a prism, and it breaks up, you have to say that all of them must have been there before, only they were contained in a oneness so intense that you couldn't separate them. But if you have the right tool, then you perceive their separation. Is that correct? The world of the mazalos is that prism. It differentiates the correct energy so that each one goes where it has to go and conducts the affairs, right, of each thing or event or moment of time or object or person or whatever it is in this world. Another analogy might be, if that's not good enough, imagine if you look up from this world, look at the astrological world. An analogy you could say is that imagine if you looked up and you saw the bottom of an enormous reservoir of water, enormous tank of water. Inside the tank, the water is all one mass of water. But the bottom of the tank has holes. And the water is pouring out in, you understand? The water is pouring out in individual channels, each one watering the exact point on this world that it needs to reach. Okay? In fact, you know what's remarkable? The word mazal in Hebrew, you know what it really means? It means to flow. You know that? You know what nozel is? You know what a nozel is in Hebrew? A liquid. You know what mazal means? Katal yizal. It means the mazal means the place where the flow of higher energy is directed and flows down here. It's the connection between the higher source and how it's drawn down or flows down, not into this world. How do we translate mazal in English? Luck. You know what luck means? That which is specifically detached from any meaning. Isn't it? Good luck means, you know, good luck. When you pull a handle, I hope you get 3 cherries, you know. By accident. Again, luck in English, luck to our uncircumcised ears, mazal. When you say, you know, what exactly do you mean when you say mazal tov? What exactly do you mean? If you don't know what you mean, you are very close to being an idol worshipper. You know that? When you go to a wedding and you say, and you whatever auspicious occasion it is, you say, mazel tov. You mean, may your marriage turn out like 3 accidental cherries? Is that by happy accident? Is that what you mean? That's not Jewish. You know what mazel tov means? It doesn't mean may you have good luck, chas v'shalom. Doesn't mean that. It means may the affairs that are about to transpire here be energized by a source that comes all the way from us. That's what it means in as positive a devolution as possible. Doesn't mean may you be disconnected. Who would want that? But the mazalos are the energies, the place, the concept, the world that is causing the differentiation from oneness into the particulate separate channels, each one of which, okay, so the astrological forces are those forces which come down, all from one source of course, but they come down in our world that's revealed as multiple, and each one comes down and is the cause, it either brings into existence or it causes anhaga, it causes the conduct of that object or event in this world. That's what the mazalos are. Actually, a little awkward to talk about this with the tape recorders going, but in the Kabbalistic literature, these channels are known as tsinorot, tsinoiris, pipelines. Each one is a tube or a pipeline that brings down a shaft of flow of energy. What is the analogy that's given in the Kabbalistic sources? Talk about white light or about water. There they talk about, if you read the Kabbalistic literature, it talks there about the oneness being the brain inside the head, and the multiplicity being the hairs on the outside of the head. The hairs, can you see what's happening? Inside your head, your grasp of yourself is always an intact oneness. That's a unique feature of the human mind, is that no matter what you're doing with your mind, you always experience yourself as one, unless you have certain problems. But if you are healthy psychologically, your grasp of yourself is always a oneness. The Das Tfunis goes into this in detail. That no matter whether you're functioning with memory or creativity or intellect, whatever department it is, you don't have the feeling that you're moving from one department to another. Is that correct? You have the feeling that it's all of you all the time. Within you there's a oneness. In the mind there can be such a thing. But when that energy bursts forth to the outer world, it comes out as individual. The hairs are called tzinoiros. They're called, you know what the word se'ar means in Hebrew? Se'ar is a hair. But it's beautiful to realize that the word se'ar is the same word in Hebrew as a shi'ur. Shi'ur means a finite, statutory amount of a thing, right? A packaged amount as opposed to all of the thing. Or the other application of that word in Hebrew, shi'ur, sa'ar, is sha'ar. What is a sha'ar? A gate. A gate means something that allows only a certain defined size through. Do you understand? There's a limitation down to, that's what this is. Of course, that's why the hairs are such, that's why hair is such a powerful Kabbalistic focus. The energy that bursts forth from the inner world and manifests in the outer world, in fact, is manifest in the body by the growth of hair. Hair grows on those parts of the body that are the root of organs of hashpa. Any organ in the body that is able to produce something that is created or produced in the world, the reason that it's surrounded by hair, yes, the head, for example, where all outflow begins. Under the arms you have hair. Because your arm is the first organ, limb, in the devolving structure of the body that can reach out and achieve and change and affect production in the world, right? Etc. Men also are more hairy than women because men put out the creative energy into the world. Women are those who take it and absorb it inwardly and build inwardly. In fact, this is the reason, Kabbalistically, why Jewish married women cover their hair. Married woman doesn't have a hair cover. There's a tremendous light that shines from her. Tremendous light that is revealing tremendous intimacy. But again, that's, I'm sure none of you are interested in this, and that's not our, save that for those who are interested for some other time. Let's talk about the application of this principle to us. The beard, in a man, the beard is a, people Kabbalistically sensitive, if a hair falls out, they keep it. If a hair falls out, they keep it. The Yud Gimel Minas Rachamim, the 13 attributes of Hashem's mercy, deeply related to the manifestation of the 13 points of the beard. The Gaon of Vilna was once sitting with his son on his knee, and the child was playing with his beard, and a few hairs were pulled out. So the Gaon started in surprise, and his mother was present. And she said to him, what are you reacting like that for? When you were a child, you pulled out many of your father's hairs from his beard. The Gaon went into Golos immediately, you know that? He decreed on himself a decree of exile. He wandered the roads in penitence. Anyway, we're getting sidetracked. Why are you sidetracking? Let's get back to our subject. We have here the following concept. There's a bringing down of oneness, which splits through what we call the mazalos, the zodiac, into the particulate control lines, if you like, that strike ground in this world as the objects and events of this world. By the way, you know that's why there are 12. Why are there 12 of them? Why 12? You know that in the Kabbalistic system, 12 is always the full expression of the oneness of a thing. Do you know that? 12 is always, listen carefully, 12 in Torah, actually it's 13. You realize 12 is always 13. Anytime you have 12 things that are aspects of one thing, the 13th is always the oneness of those 12, isn't it? 13 things means that there are 12 disparate separate entities, but the fact that they construct one thing between them, why are there 12 tribes among the Jewish people? Because they form the oneness of the Jewish people. They're all Yaakov Avinu, they're all him in his 12 branches, right? The Shevet is a branch in Hebrew. Right? The Shevet is a branch, a branch away from the trunk, from the center. A Shevet or a Mate, it also means a branch. Is this clear? In three-dimensional space, if you look in the Kabbalistic literature, in the Maral, for example, what is the idealized version of a three-dimensional space? A cube. Is that right? Ask any mathematician. The idealized projection of any three-dimensional space is a perfect cube. 12 lines. And the fact that the lines all interconnect as one cube, they're not disparate floating around separated objects, is the 13th. Are you with me? Always. That's why 13 always means one. Take the word echad in Hebrew. Add up the letters. You get? Echad, 1, 8 and 4, 13. One, the word one. Beautiful. What language does that? It's enough to make you raving from. The word echad, one, has 13 emanations. The word ahava, in case you're not convinced. The word love, what is love? What do we say love was? A bonding into the ultimate oneness? The word ava adds up to 13. What's the concept? The concept is that there are 12 elements. Can you see what's happening? The world of 12 zodiac elements, 12 mazolos, is the world of taking Hashem's oneness and splitting it into the multiplicity that demonstrates His oneness down here, but while in disparate and differentiated form. So far so good. Is the idea clear? Not even one nod? Somebody? Let's go back to idolatry and see if we can understand it. You know what idolatry is? Idolatry is not some crazed individual who cooks up a figment of his imagination and then says that it created him. No, that's not idolatry. Idolatry is a person who looks to the source accurately. This person knows exactly where to look. He doesn't look there or there or there. He looks up exactly where it's coming from. And he follows the energies all the way up to their source. But he doesn't go all the way. You know why? You know what astrology is? Let's talk about astrology for a moment. You go to an astrologer to get an opinion about what will be. You know what an astrologer does? We're talking about genuine astrology. I'm not talking about the back page of the Sunday Times or whatever. That you will meet a tall, dark, handsome idiot. We're not talking about that. We're talking about the real thing, which may be hard to find today. Although there's no reason why it shouldn't exist today. No reason why it should not exist. Torah talks a lot about astrology. Somebody who genuinely knows what's doing. Prophecy is a genuine telling of the future. Astrology has got nothing to do with telling the future. Astrology, he's just reading the way the energies are disposed now. Are you with me? Prophecy is a genuine knowledge of the future in things that are hidden. And that we don't have today. Since I'm shaking this, like, we don't have prophecy. The Gemara says the only vestiges of prophecy left on earth today are in children. Children too young to speak. Dogs. And people who are insane to the extent that communication is not possible with it. Right? Those three areas still have vestiges of prophecy. But in any meaningful, cohesive, cogent fashion, we do not have prophecy anymore. But astrology is not telling the future. Astrology is just looking at the energies, the pipelines, as they begin to bring down the energy, so you can figure out what's going to be. It's not reading the future, it's reading the present. Is this clear? Example. If you take a seed, and you take an acorn and you cut it open, you won't see a little oak tree inside. You don't see an oak tree. You just see a white material. But that doesn't matter. If you take that to a person who knows those things, and you say to him, what is this? The person will look at the seed and he'll tell you, you know, in 5 years, if you plant this in the ground, you know what it will be? It will be this big and look like this, and the leaves will be this. Tell you, describe exactly. Telling the future? Not telling the future, just know seeds. An astrologer is not somebody who reads the future. Just a person who knows how the energies are disposed there. You go to a clever doctor. Doctor can examine a patient and he can tell what's likely to be in 5 years' time. Telling the future? Not at all. He's just telling things that may not be revealed to you yet, which are the elements that produce a process, is this clear? Which will have results. Astrology is simply looking up, which can be done. Why not? You can look up to where the channels are. You can't look up into the oneness. There you can't see. You know why, by the way? Why can you not see up into the world of oneness? Think with me. Why is it impossible for a human being to be alive? Why was Moshe Rabbeinu allowed to see only 49 of the 50 gates? Human being cannot see me while he's alive. Why did Hashem let Moshe see only 49 of the 50 gates of ultimate wisdom? Why could you only see 49? Why can you only see the 49? Why can't you see up into where they're all one? Because up there, you don't exist. If you would get there, there's no you. There's no differentiation of you as a separate observer up there. If you could get into that root where everything is one, you're also part of the oneness. Are you with me? To be alive means that you differentiate a fragment over here. So you can only witness things that are in the world of differentiation. An astrologer is simply someone that looks up to where the point of origin of the differentiation begins and then reads the signs that you may not be sensitive to. It tells you what's likely to be. An astrologer can't tell you exactly what will be because they could come down disposed in various ways. Can't tell you for sure. Can't tell you for sure. Can tell you for sure what the energies are and therefore calculate what's likely to be. You have to know how they get put together. That's a skill. It's a special skill. But to read the signs could be done. What is idolatry? Listen carefully. Idolatry is a person that looks to the same place. They're not looking to ridiculous sources. They're not looking sideways. And they're looking to the source. They're looking towards Hashem exactly. But they stop at the place where the differentiation... You know why? You know why? Because that's where the goods are delivered. That's where the goods are delivered. He doesn't care to go further because what's it got to do with me? Again, let me share with you an analogy. That's the most beautiful. I heard Rav Simcha Wasserman tell, this is the example that he gave. This whole long, clumsy discussion that I'm trying to share with you, he put into the following few beautiful words. He said, Avodah Zorah, idolatry, is a fellow who walks into a department store. Just listen to the genius of this analogy. Is a person who walks into a department store and he wants a camera, the camera behind the counter, which costs 1500. He only has 150. So he walks up to the fellow behind the counter and he says to him quietly, look, you slip me the camera and I'll slip you 150. That's idolatry. You hear what's going on? It's a person who goes to the people who run the departments, the places where they deliver the goods, because he's interested in the goods being delivered. Does he care about who runs the overall business? Who owns the store? Who's the boss and the owner of the department? What's it going to do with me? He's prepared to pay off the departmental characters because they deliver the goods. What's he prepared to pay? Prepared to pay. Idolaters throughout history, they pay. But only a fraction of the price. The real price that Hashem wants from you is everything that you are for the rest of your life. Every breath and every moment of existence in this world and the next. That's what he wants you to give him. And idolatry, just pay off some part of what you are. A few young girls here and there, sacrifice to this God, some money, some food. What for? You pay off the departmental sources who deliver the goods. That's what he's interested in. Is this clear? Think about the Greek gods. Think about the Greek gods. The Greeks had a whole herd of gods, right? A whole pantheon of gods. A god of fertility and of love and of war. Did the Greeks have a god who created the world? Nope. Why not? Who needs him? Who needs him? Are you with me? You need a god of war. You need a god of love. You need a god of this and that and the other. Because they hold the reins. They are the channels that bring down what I need. So then we deal with. Idolatry is not going to a false place. It's going to the right place. That's why the Torah deals with it as if it's real. It is completely real. And can you see why the Torah uses Hashem's names? It is. You know what Hashem's names are, other than the Yud-Kei Vav-Kei? They are the names that bring Hashem's oneness down into the world. You know what the Shem Elohim means? The Shem Elohim, the name Elohim means that divine essence that brings the oneness of Hashem's reality into the differentiated world. You know that Elohim in Gematria adds up to the same as Ateva, the word for nature. You know what the Rambam says? The Rambam says, you know how idolatry began? What a beautiful description. He says that in the early generations of the world's history, people worshipped Hashem. They were in direct contact with Hashem. Then they said to each other, surely if you have a king who's greatly honored, it's fitting to honor his emissaries, his viceroys, his agents. Surely you should honor them as honor of the king? So they said, yes, therefore we should honor the sun and the wind and the moon and all the forces in nature, since those are all the methods of Hashem's bringing down and conducting the affairs of the world. So they began to worship the sun and the moon and the planets, etc. And then they forgot about Hashem. And they were left with the worship of these elements of nature. Why? Why they forget about Hashem? Because who needs him? Who needs him? What they're interested in is who can deliver the goods. The sun, the moon, the wind, nature, that everything should... That's fine. By the way, you know what graven images are? You know what a graven image is? It's only a tangible focus to indicate to him the thing that he's relating to, which is the higher force. He's not relating to this graven image, this totem or this piece of rock, as if it created him. That individual is not an idolater. He's psychotically deranged. That's what he is. Right? This is the person who makes a graven image just to be a focus, to remind him to focus on of the deeper energy that's coming down. And by the way, you know why they are almost always human? Why are they almost always human, these graven images? In religions that worship images or manifestations of the human? Because you know what's really being worshipped? Why is this person, let's take it further. Why is he going up to the departmental points of origin? Because he wants the goods to be delivered. Why? Because you know what he cares about? This is not somebody who only goes halfway instead of going all the way. This is a person who looks at himself instead of Hashem. The real worship is worship of the self. Is this clear? That's why the Gemara puts it this way. The Gemara says, Tzadikim, righteous people, Hashem, yes, Oymed Alem, God, Hashem stands over them. Like it says, Vashem Nitzav Olav. Hashem was standing over Yaakov by the dream when he had his dream. But evil people, Rishoim, Elohim Oimdim Aleim, their gods stand over they stand over their gods. Like it says, V'paroi Oimed Ale Yor, and Pharaoh was standing over the Nile. The Nile was the Egyptian god. What does it mean? A tzaddik puts himself in this position and he says, Hashem, whatever you want, I give to you. That's Avodas Hashem. A Rasha stands in this position and he says, Hashem, this is what you must do for me. You understand what's happening? Exact turnaround of what it should be. Is this clear? Avodas Hashem means, I serve you whatever you want. You want my son? Whatever you want. You have to kill your own son? If that's what he demands, whatever he wants, I give. That's what I'm here for. Avodah Zarah means, whatever I want, you provide. Again, I don't want to say too much, but just a hint. You know, Judaism begins... Listen well, I hope you'll hear it. Judaism begins with a man sacrificing his son for Hashem. Did you hear that? Doesn't sound like it. Judaism begins with a man sacrificing his son for Hashem. No, it's not clear. There is a system that is the exact opposite of what Judaism is. Not an accident. That's the idea. So therefore the concept is this. The difference between Avodas Hashem and Avodas Zarah is, you look in the right direction. This person's looking exactly in the right direction. But then he stops when he gets to the point where the goods are provided and he doesn't go all the way. What Hashem wants from us, what Torah is, Avodas Hashem is going all the way. You don't stop with the departmental. What's that? That's not the point. Who? Avodas Hashem is you're not looking for the shefa, for the outflow, not looking at that. That's why we don't get involved in astrology. You know why astrology is forbidden? You know why astrology is not forbidden because it's nonsense. You know it's brought down in halacha? That if you're walking down the street minding your own business and an accredited astrologer walks up to you and says to you, I can see that this and this and this is going to happen to you tomorrow. You are allowed to believe it. You know that? You're allowed to believe it and you may even take steps to avert what's going to happen if it's not good. Why not? But you're forbidden to go and see an astrologer. It's a Torah prohibition of Tamim Tiyah. It's a Torah prohibition to go and seek the opinion of an astrologer or a palm reader or a tea leaf reader or somebody reads your tefillin or somebody, you know, or your mezuzahs. I'm not talking about looking if they're kasha. I'm talking about that. I'm talking about reading what the future will be from the wrinkles in your forehead or the lines on your palm or how your tea leaves lie in a cup or all that stuff, especially if they charge you. Why is it forbidden? Do you understand? Because going to ask an astrologer, you know what? You know what the Talmud Yerushalmi, absolutely chilling thing. The Talmud Yerushalmi, you can look it up yourself. It's a very beautiful discussion of the subject at the end of the sixth parak in Shabbos. The Talmud Yerushalmi says, you know what the punishment is for seeking astrological advice? Do you know what the punishment is for seeking astrological advice? That when the person tells you what will happen, you can't change it. The punishment is it will happen. You wanted to know. Now it will happen to you. What's the role of a Jew? Ein mazal Yisrael. We are not subject to the mazalis. We live above them. We project ourselves into the oneness that transcends them. They dance to our tune, not we to theirs. If you go and ask astrological advice, you know what you're saying? You're saying there's a system, and either the system is, that's the way it will be. Oh, so you're making yourself part of the system. You believe you're subject to the system. Punishment is, you become part of the system. You know what will be, but now you're subject to it. And can't change it. That's a punishment. That's exactly what you wanted, didn't you? Why did you go, Tom him to you. You trust Hashem, you don't deal with those. There's a condition, of course. You want Hashem to treat you transcending the system. You want Him to treat you beyond the forces and the mechanical must be forces. You have to live beyond them. Midah keneged midah, right? You have to put yourself there. Avraham Avinu, Abraham. He lived beyond. Hashem dealt with him in a completely miraculous fashion, but he first put himself there. He's prepared to sacrifice everything for Hashem, take himself completely out of the system. Then you can dealt with outside of the system. You know, it says, I hear this well, with sensitive ear. You remember what it says in Chumash? Hashem appeared to him and said to him, you will have a son. You remember this? Hashem appeared to him and said, you will have a son. What was his response? His response was, but Hashem, it says in the stars that I will never have a child. Listen to this conversation. Hashem appears to Avraham Avinu and gives him an absolute prophetic clarity. Says to him, clearly you will have a child, a son. Avraham Avinu turns to Hashem and he says, but Hashem, it's impossible. The stars say otherwise. Who are you arguing with? Well, what's going on? Hashem appears to you and tells you, I mean, who's in control here? What's going on? Hashem appears and gives you a prophecy and you say, Hashem, that's very nice, but astrologically, you know what he meant? He meant this. Hashem, you're telling me that I have a child, but you're telling me in your stars, which are written by you, that I will not. That's a good question. You're telling me that I'll have a child. But you're telling me the stars are your words. The stars are your energies. They're the way you control what will be with me. So how can you be telling me here that I have a child and you're telling me in your stars that I won't? So it says, Vayetze Oysa Achutz, Hashem took him outside. The simple pshat is, he took him out of his tent and he showed him the stars and he said, etc., etc. You know what the Kabbalistic pshat is? He took him outside the stars. And he said, what are you looking at those for? Those got nothing to do with you. Those are caused by you. They don't cause you. You start way before where they start. After you are what you are, the stars will take their shape according to you. How is it, as an aside, how is it that the stars could be true if they're not true? That's a deep, wonderful subject, which is perhaps not a little late to go into now. Just a hint. The stars did say right, but you didn't know how to read them from down here. That's all. You know, it says, are you with me? When Chana was davening, we discussed Chana last time we met. When she was davening and she was shaking backwards and forwards, Eli thought she was drunk. Eli thought she was drunk. But before accusing her, he wouldn't do a thing like that. He's a very great man. He went to ask Hashem. No less. He went to read the Urim Batumim. And they lit up with the letters, Shikorab, drunk woman. You can't do better than that. So he went and said to her, what are you doing in the Mishkan drunk? She said, sir, I'm not drunk, I'm a broken-hearted woman. He went back and realized he had, the letters were Shikora, but it depends how you read them. You can either read Shikora or Kashera, a kosher woman, or Kesara, like Sarah. Depends how you read them. Nothing wrong with the letters. The stars know what they're doing. The question is from down here, are you looking? Now you put yourself, there's so many examples. It says that we were 400 years to be in slavery. You remember? And we went out after 210. But Hashem's prediction? I guess they know where to count from. It was 400 years from the birth of Yitzchak. They know where to count from. The stars indicate, the energies come down and they indicate certain things. Those things are true. But a Jew is the cause of those. We're not the result. You want to be the result? You want to be a mechanical, natural human being? Then you treat it naturally. That's what you want. That's what you get. How do you transcend them? How do you put yourself into that world that transcends them? The secret is you take the finite and physical world of your body, the lowest aspects of the physical finite world, and you use them to do that which is mystical or spiritual. You do a mitzvah. You do one mitzvah down here, and you live above the stuff. The Gemara says this. What better example? If you look there in Yerushalmi, you'll find a whole list of wonderful examples. But the Bavli says that Rabbi Akiva's daughter, you know, the Talmud says that Rabbi Akiva was told that his daughter would die on her wedding day. He was told by an astrologer that he could see that his daughter was going to die on the day of her wedding. And Rabbi Akiva was extremely distressed. I mean, you're not talking about fools. What happened? The girl got married. She got married. And at her wedding, as she sat at the Suda of her wedding, she took a long hairpin out of her hair. And in order just to store it, she placed it in the wall, she stuck it into the wall behind her, and transfixed a cobra that was about to strike. And the reptile was pinned to the wall and killed. The sages gathered round, and they said to her, what happened? Nothing, nothing. They finally traced carefully the events of the day, and what happened was, she was sitting there as a kala, you know, sitting on the chair of the kala, and at that incredible moment of her life, the one moment of a girl's life when if ever she's allowed to think a little bit of her own happiness, a man walked in who was a beggar and didn't have a meal, and nobody was noticing him because it was Rabbi Akiva's daughter's wedding, but she noticed him, and she gave him her food, and saved her life. Why? Because that's not natural. That's not natural. The act of tzedakah, of giving away what you have to somebody else, that's the natural world doesn't do that. Animals don't do that. Animals don't do that. Natural world doesn't do that. And at the moment of your life when there's justification, when there's an intense focus on yourself and your future, to think outward, that's not natural. You live in an unnatural fashion, then you get dealt with the unnatural fashion. You want to live in a natural fashion and put yourself into the whole zodiac, you want to run around asking people what the energy is saying, what it says here and what it says over there, and what it, but then you get dealt with that. Then how you get dealt. You want to use the physical world to climb out of the physical world, then you get dealt with that way. Let me finish, it's getting late. Let me finish with, much more to say here of course, but let me finish with just one further depth in this subject. Yes, is that okay? Let's just hear one more depth in this, just to bring it home, and then we'll stop. Let me share with you just a beautiful avenue of insight. I heard this again from Rav Wasserman. Just a beautiful insight that brings it all home. The Mishnah says in Sukkah, which is where we're really heading, right? To Yom Kippur, come out of Yom Kippur with the Lulav and Esrog, like victorious, it says like weapons almost. Yom Sukkah says the following thing. Amazing thing. In the description of the Simchas Beis HaShoeva, the great happiness of Sukkah, the Gemara says what used to happen in the days of the Beis HaMikdash, in the temple, when the temple stood, this is what used to happen. At one point of the celebrations, he used to go and stand on the steps of the Beis HaMikdash, and he used to say the following thing. In this place where we stand now, our forefathers stood once, referring to the ancestors of the Jewish people who were idolaters. You know, Abraham Avinu was descended, right? His father was an idolater, idol worshippers, and we transcended the world of the stars in our growth to being the Jewish people. But we started under the dominion of the stars in an idolatrous beginning. So the Mishnah says like this, that our forefathers who stood in this place, it says, Acharei Melahechal, their backs were to the sanctuary, Upnei Melashemesh, and their faces were to the sun. They worshipped the sun, nature. And they worshipped the sun and they accepted, they were idolaters. But we, now that we know, come to know Hashem, Jewish people, their eyes were to the sun and the forces of nature, but our eyes are to Hashem, right? That's the way the Mishnah puts it, is V'einenu l'ko. Our eyes are turned to Hashem. Yudkei, that name of Hashem, why that is, not going to go into now, but our eyes are focused on Hashem. That's what the Mishnah says. Rabbi Yehuda says, that's not the way to say it. The way to say it is, Anu Leka, we are for Hashem, Uleka Enenu, and to Hashem our eyes are turned. Let's listen carefully. There's an argument in the Mishnah here. An argument in the Mishnah is not a simple matter. But an argument in the Mishnah goes very, very deep. It goes to the root of the world and what we are about. What is this argument? It seems almost insignificant, this argument. You say the words this way, that way. What are the words? The opinion of the sages is, we say, our eyes are turned to Hashem. Einenu leka. Our eyes are turned to Hashem. We do not turn to the sun and the moon and the wind. We turn to Hashem. Rabbi Yehuda says, no, that's terribly wrong. Don't say that. The way to say it is, Anu leka, we Hashem are for you. Uleka enenu. And then we say that our eyes are turned to you. What is this argument? What is this argument? Again, what are the words? Do we say our eyes are turned to you? Or do we say we are for you and then we turn our eyes to you? What is this? Beautiful, beautiful understanding. Fantastic understanding, and this, couldn't think of a better message to take into Yom Kippur. You know what's wrong with saying that our eyes are turned to you, Hashem? You know what's wrong with saying that? If you turn around and you say our forefathers were idolaters and they looked to the forces of nature, etc., but we, Hashem, look to you. You know what's wrong with that? Something very, very wrong with that. You know what's wrong? Why did our ancestors look towards the forces of nature? Because they wanted the goods. That's why. They looked to the forces. Why would they look at the sun and the moon and the stars? Because they care about themselves. That's what an idolater does. He commands his God with what he wants. So they turn to the forces of nature, right, for their needs. And now you say you turn to Hashem for your needs? That's what you mean? Sure, it's much better than them. At least you're turning to the right place. But you haven't changed the focus. What you are saying, he said to the sages, Rabbi Yehuda said, all you're doing is substituting Hashem for the idols. Very good. Not complaining. At least ask him. But who counts? The idolaters, in their lives, what counted was them. How did they hope to get what they needed from their idols? From the forces of nature. And now you're saying, what counts in your life? You! Where do you look to get what you need? Hashem! It's not that much of an improvement. You still care about you. In essence, are you with me? In essence, all you care about still is you. Baruch Hashem, you're going to the right place. But that's not Avodas Hashem. And therefore he changed the words. That's not the way to say it. Anu leka, the first thing is we for you. That's what you say. Never mind what I need. The first statement, the point of departure from Avodah Zorah, is not whether you look halfway to the points of the departments, or you look all the way. That's not the first point of origin is, are you focusing on me or focusing on him? That's the first point. First, before you talk about your needs, the first thing you do is you say, Hashem, I'm for you. That's the first. Let's get that clear. After you say that you're not here for me, I'm here for you, then you can say, and now Hashem, I look to you for my needs. Fine. After you've clarified that the relationship is that I'm here to serve him, then you say you have needs and you turn to him. But let's get that clear first. Beautiful, beautiful interpretation of the Mishnah from one of the Torah greats of the previous generation. What it leaves us with, and what we need to think about and take home, is that Yom Kippur is a time for going to essence. Yom Kippur is not a time for going halfway, right, to your astrological favorite, right, whether it's the Sunday Times or the graven image in your back garden or the graven image graven on your banknotes or your any other images, whether they be solid in stone or flitting on a screen, delivering sewage into your living room. Whatever it happens to be, yeah, if it's that image, if you look into that for your information and your needs and your nurture, suckling, that's where you're suckling life from, they haven't got hope on Yom Kippur. Yom Kippur is the time of return to essence. It recalls the day of the Yovel, which is when the shofar was sounded and everybody went back to his inheritance and the place that he came from. The depth of that just doesn't just mean that people went back to their families. It means that they went back to the point of origin. It means you go back to the source of who you are. And the source of who you are is all the way up where you are part of the oneness. That's where you belong as a Jew. But if you're a Mazel Tov Jew, which means that you should have good luck, then good luck to you on Yom Kippur. But if you're a Avodas Hashem Jew, that muzzle doesn't mean that which is abstracted and distracted from the source. But if mazal to you means that there's a flow of energy that comes down into this world, but it traces itself into the reservoir where all the water is one body, or where the white light is all one, or to where the mind has its source of oneness with Hashem, then that is the method to use and the focus that we need in order to have a Gemar Chasimah Tov.